Let's see. Where was I? I don't know. I was somewhere. Let me read you what the Science Fiction Encyclopedia says about Charles Beaumont. It's not very much. It's a lot less than people like H. Bedford Jones and people you've never heard of. Charles Beaumont, the pseudonym by which American story and scriptwriter Charles Nutt, N-U-T-T, 1929 to 1967, is best known, though he wrote some non-SF under other names. He began publishing his blend of horror and SF with The Devil You Say for Amazing in 1951. Most of his work is collected in The Hunger, 1957. Well, they've given us English title names here, which they're not. His stories were collected in Night Ride and Other Journeys, The Hunger and Other Stories, Yonder, The Magic Man, and one novel, The Intruder. And a few years back, The Best of Beaumont. There's also two books of nonfiction, one of them called Remember, Remember, which is a book of nostalgia, and a book on sports.
Omnibus of Speed.
Omnibus of Speed, yeah. He did. Beaumont's work combines humor and horror in a slick style, extremely effective in underlining the grimness of his basic inspiration. As a film writer, he scripted Queen of Outer Space in 1958 and The Seven Faces of Dr. Lao in 1964, and worked with Ray Russell and Richard Matheson on several horror films. He also collaborated with Chad Oliver on the brief Claude Adams series in FNSF 55 and 56, and edited a horror anthology, The Fiend in You, 1962. He was struck in 1964 by a savage illness which ravaged and eventually killed him. It's all right to talk about Chuck Beaumont, but if you've never read Chuck Beaumont, well, you've missed a great deal. Let me read you, very quickly, while my three guests sit and listen to this, short story called Place of Meeting. It swept down from the mountains, a loose, crystal-smelling wind, an autumn chill of moving wetness, down from the mountains and into the town where it set the dead trees hissing and the signboards creaking. And it even went into the church because the bell was ringing and there was no one to ring the bell. The people in the yard stopped their talk and listened to the rusty music. Big Jim Croner listened, too. Then he cleared his throat and clapped his hands. Thick hands, calloused and work-dirtied. All right, he said loudly. All right, let us settle down now. He walked out from the group and turned. Who's got the list?
Got it right here, Jim, a woman said, coming forward with a loose-leaf folder.
All present?
Everybody except that they're German, Mr. Gruninger.
Croner smiled. He made a megaphone of his hands. Gruninger! Bartold Gruninger! A small man with a mustache called out excitedly,
Ja, Svashver den Friedhof zu finden?
All right, that's all we want to know, whether you was here or not. Croner studied the pages carefully. Then he reached into the back pocket of his overalls and withdrew a stub of pencil and put the tip to his mouth. Now, before we start off, he said to the group, I want to know, is there anybody here that's got a question or anything to ask? He looked over the crowd of silent faces. Anybody don't know who I am? No?
It came another wind then, mountains scattered and fast. It billowed dresses, set damp hair moving. It pushed over pewter vases and smashed dead roses and hydrangeas to swirling dust against the gritty tombstones. Its clean rain smell was gone now, though, for it had passed over the fields with the odors of rotting life. Croner made a check mark in the notebook.
Anderson! He shouted. Edward L.
A man in overalls like Croner stepped forward.
Andy, you covered Skagit Valley, Snohomish and King counties, as well as Seattle and the rest?
Yes, sir.
What you got to report?
They're all dead, Anderson said.
You looked everywhere? You was real careful?
Yes, sir. Ain't nobody alive in the whole state.
Croner nodded and made another check mark.
That's all. Andy. Next. Avakian. Katina.
A woman in a wool skirt and gray blouse walked up from the back, waving her arms. She started to speak. Croner tapped his stick.
Listen here for a second, folks, he said. For those that don't know how to talk English, you know what this is all about. So when I ask my question, you just nod up and down for yes, like this, and sideways, like this, for no. Makes it a lot easier for those of us as don't remember too good. All right?
There were murmurings and whispered consultations, and for a little while, the yard was full of noise. The woman called Avakian kept nodding.
Fine, Croner said. Now, Miss Avakian, you covered what? Iran, Iraq, Turkey, Syria. Did you find anybody alive?
The woman stopped nodding.
No, she said. No.
Croner checked the name.
Let's see here. Boleslavsky. Peter. You go on back, Miss Avakian.
The man in bright city clothes walked briskly to the tree clearing.
Yes, sir, he said. What have you got for us?
The man shrugged. Well, I'll tell you. I went over New York with a fine-tooth comb. Then I hit Brooklyn and Jersey. Nothing, man. Nothing nowhere.
He is right, the dark-faced woman said in a tremulous voice. I was there, too.
Only the dead in the streets, all over the city. In the cars I looked even, in the offices. Everywhere is people dead.
Chavez, Pietro, Baja California.
All dead, Señor Chief.
Ciotto, Ruggiero, Capri.
The man from Capri shook his head violently.
Denman, Charlotte, Southern United States.
Dead as doornails.
Elgar, David S., Ferrazio, Ignatz, Goldfarb, Bernard, Halpern, Ives, Krennic, O'Brien.
The names exploded in the pale evening air like deep gunshots. There was much head shaking, many people saying, no, no. At last, Kroner stopped marking. He closed the notebook and spread his big workman's hands. He saw the round eyes, the trembling mouths, the young faces. He saw all the frightened people. The girl began to cry. She sank to the damp ground and covered her face and made these crying sounds. An elderly man put his hand on her head. The elderly man looked sad, but not afraid. Only the young ones seemed afraid.
Settle down now, Kroner said firmly. Settle on down. Now listen to me. I'm going to ask you all the same question one more time because we got to be sure.
He waited for them to grow quiet.
All right. This here is all of us, everyone. We've covered all the spots. Did anybody here find one single solitary sign of life?
The people were silent. The wind had died again, so there was no sound at all. Across the corroded wire fence, the gray meadows lay strewn with the carcasses of cows and horses, and in one of the fields, sheep. No flies buzzed near the dead animals. There were no maggots burrowing, no vultures. The sky was clean of birds. And in all the untended rolling hills of grass and weeds which had once sung and pulsed with a million voices, in all the land there was only this immense stillness now. Still as years. Still as the unheard motion of the stars. Kroner watched the people. The young woman in the gay print dress, the tall African with his bright paint and cultivated scars, the fierce-looking Swede looking not so fierce now in this graying twilight. He watched all the tall and short and old and young people from all over the world pressed together now, a vast, silent polyglot in this country meeting place, this always lonely and long deserted spot, deserted even before the gas bombs and the disease and the flying pestilences that had covered the earth in 3 days and three nights. Deserted. Forgotten.
Talk to us, Jim,
the woman who had handed him the notebook said. She was new. Kroner put the list inside his big overalls pocket.
Tell us, someone else said. How shall we be nourished? What will we do?
The world's all dead, a child moaned. Dead is dead, the whole world.
Todo el mundo. Monsieur Kroner, what will we do?
Kroner smiled.
Do?
He looked up through the still-hanging poison cloud, the dun blanket, up to where the moon was now risen in full coldness. His voice was steady, but it lacked life.
What some of us have done before, he said, we'll go back and wait. It ain't the first time. It ain't the last.
A little fat bald man with old eyes sighed and began to waver in the October dusk. The outline of his form wavered and disappeared in the shadows under the trees where the moonlight did not reach. Others followed him as Kroner talked.
Same thing we'll do again and likely keep on doing. We'll go back and sleep. And we'll wait. And then it'll start all over again and folks will build their cities. New folks with new blood. And then we'll wake up. Maybe a long time yet, but it ain't so bad. It's quiet, and time passes.
He lifted a small girl of 15 or 16 with pale cheeks and red lips.
Come on now. Why, just think of the appetite you'll have all built up.
The girl smiled. Kroner faced the crowd and waved his hands, large hands rough from the stone of midnight pyramids and the feel of muskets, boils speckled from night hours in packing plants and trucking lines, broken by the impact of a tomahawk and a machine gun bullet, but white where the dirt was not caked, and bloodless. Old hands, old beyond years. As he waved, the wind came limping back from the mountains. It blew the heavy iron bell high in the steepled white barn, and set the signboards creaking and lifted ancient dusts and hissed again through the dead trees. Kroner watched the air turn black. He listened to it fill with the flappings and the flutterings and the squeakings. He waited. Then he stopped waving and sighed and began to walk. He walked to a place of vines and heavy brush. Here he paused for a moment and looked out at the silent place of high, dark grass, of hidden, huddled tombs, of scrolls and stone-frozen children stained silver in the night's wet darkness. At the crosses he did not look. The people were gone. The place was empty. Kroner kicked away the foliage. Then he got into the coffin and closed the lid. Soon, he was asleep.
Place of Meeting by Charles Beaumont. Dead 20 years today. My guests in the studio tonight, Richard Matheson, one of the great American writers, Roger Anker, potentially one of the great American biographers, and Chris Beaumont, who has written for Fame and for Downtown last season, and who just did a Perry Mason, and who is the son of a great writer. Where do we start? Who starts? Who talks about Chuck Beaumont? Don't rush.
I'd forgotten that story. How marvelously Chuck wrote, the descriptive abilities he had, and what a wonderful notion it was that what do the vampires do if there's a nuclear devastation? How do they survive? And the way he handled it was exquisite. I had read that story many years ago, but I'd forgotten how marvelous it was and how wonderfully he wrote.
It's the voice of Richard Matheson. You were Chuck's contemporary. You and he were writing at almost exactly the same time when he got started, as I recall.
Yeah, we met in 1951 when I came to California, and I was a little bit ahead of him. I had sold one collection of stories, but he rapidly overtook me, and we were sort of like spurs and inspirations to each other. He'd have a collection, I'd have a collection. He did a straight novel, mainstream novel, then I did one. And it was a very wholesome type of competition and very stimulating.
Did you guys have any idea that the two of you, with I guess Bob Sheckley, were the three most formative writers of that period? I mean, the period of Sturgeon and Del Rey and Asimov and all of those had passed, and now there was a new kind of breeze blowing in about the same time as Pacific Jazz was coming in, Chet Baker and Jerry Mulligan. You guys sort of started to come in, and Chuck wrote in on the jazz too, Black Country and Red Beans and Rice Lears and Playboy, and you were doing that kind of stuff for FNSF. And those of us who were coming out of high school and wanted to be writers, we looked at your work and we marveled. Did you have any idea that you were that hot?
I think if anybody ever accomplishes anything, it's only in a state of total unawareness that they're doing it. They're just doing their thing at the time. If it ever occurred to them for a moment that I'm hot or I'm really representing something, they would just fall all to pieces and do nothing.
Ray Bradbury tells the story about you guys all sitting around, you and John Tomerlin and George Clayton Johnson, one of the great inspired madmen of our time.
Mm-hmm.
And can you talk about those sessions and tell us what it was like?
Well, we would help each other. If any one of us ran into a snag in a story, we would just sit down, and in moments, someone would solve the problem. Usually the meeting would, I wouldn't say degenerate, it would elevate into a state of great hysterical humor. I was talking to my son just before we started this program and saying that I remember that it was the funniest group of people that I've ever known in my life, to the point where you're sitting gasping with the tears running down your face, and it just kept on growing and was built up by each person. It was just a marvelous tapestry of absolutely bizarre humor, and they all had incredible senses of humor.
How was Chad in that group then?
Yeah, Chad in his quiet way was a marvel too. There was a symbiosis there that was just absolutely outstanding, and I've never seen its like again since that.
Chris, you were how old at that time? Were you around at that time?
I was around, and I had a 9 o'clock bedtime that was a complete fiction, because I would go to bed at 9, and then they would arrive, and 10 o'clock would roll around, and I would still be up because the laughter was wonderful, loud, raucous laughter, and it would I'd usually get to sleep around 1 o'clock in the morning.
Did you understand what they were talking about?
Not the particulars, but I certainly understood the spirit of it.
quite a renegade bunch they were.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah, that's...
I was back in Chicago, and I was in Chicago later. That's what year are we talking about? 50.
Well, I met you in Chicago in 1952.
I know. God, I was a loony. What are you shaking your head for, Anger? You're the youngest one in the room. You didn't know me. Roger, what got you interested in doing a biography of Charles Beaumont?
Well, I had done several author profiles and interviews over the years for a number of magazines. And Charles Beaumont was someone who I had grown up reading, as along with Mr. Matheson and Bradbury and the whole group of West Coast writers, so to speak. And the original intention was to do a three-part article on Chuck Beaumont. At the time, I was living in Chicago. This was 2 years ago. And I had set up a series of interviews out here in California and made several trips. And by the time I had reached something like 80 hours worth of taped interview and realized I had just scratched the surface, I knew I had something more than just a mere three-part magazine article. So I moved out here permanently and finished up the interviews, along working very closely with Chris, have been going through Chuck's files and letters and stories and letters of correspondence and whatnot, and I'm rapidly approaching the end of my research stage.
Bill Warren, one of our favorite people, whose books Keep Watching the Skies, two exhaustive volumes on the films of the science fiction films of the 50s, tells a story in he's talking about a film called in his review of Attack of the 50-Foot Woman. Bill Warren says, "But sex was certainly part of the appeal of this film. If you recall, it was Allison Hayes at 50 feet, which is certainly, I would say, sex. I mean, it certainly had that effect on me." He said, "Sex was certainly a part of the appeal of this film. In their interesting Playboy article, The Horror of It All, Hollis Alpert and Charles Beaumont point out that Attack of the 50-Foot Woman, quote, makes possible a literal return to the womb." That sounds like one of Chuck's remarks. He talks in volume one of Keep Watching the Skies, Bill is talking about a genuinely stupid movie called Abbott and Costello Go to Mars. And Bill says there's a strange, unpleasant story behind the credits of this film. One of the finest writers of fantasy in the 1950s was the late Charles Beaumont, many of whose stories were adapted on The Twilight Zone, and who also did several fine scripts in the 1960s, mostly for Roger Corman. His films include Burn, Witch, Burn, Premature Burial, The Wonderful World of Brothers Grimm, The Haunted Palace, The Mask of the Red Death, Seven Faces of Dr. Lau, and Corman's best movie, The Intruder, which is, of course, based on Chuck's novel, starring, of all people, William Shatner. He died in 1967 after a terrible illness. Beaumont's short stories were his real glory and read superbly well today. But before he caught fire as a writer, Beaumont held many other jobs. One was in the script department at Universal International, running the studio's script printing mimeograph. Hoping to break into films as a writer, according to his friends, Beaumont drafted an outline for an Abbott and Costello space epic and showed it to a producer on the lot. He was told that all of the scripts for Bud and Lou were handled by staff writers. In short, thanks, but no thanks. A few weeks later, while running the Mimeo, Beaumont was depressed to discover that the script he was printing was his own Abbott and Costello treatment, which was filmed as Abbott and Costello Go to Mars.
Really? I didn't know that.
You never heard that story?
I didn't know that.
No, but none of us are going to be shocked by that.
I don't know. We can talk about Queen of Outer Space later.
I recall Chuck telling me that there was this producer that I will not mention, who was really very successful at the time, and this is when Chuck was crawling in and out of the ammonia tank working on these printing jobs of his, and he had suggested that maybe it was the Abbott and Costello thing, and he said he went out in the street one day in Universal and saw this man approaching and, you know, began to raise his hand as though to greet him, and this man immediately did a fast turn on his heel and dived into a soundstage, and it always struck me as how peculiar that was, that a major producer, rather than speak to somebody like that, like speak to Chuck about this, would avoid having any contact with him at all. And that says says a lot in a descriptive way about the way the business works.
The business. It is amazing to me that Chuck was able to do as well as he did in the business. It's a heartbreaking. Chris, you're sort of, how many members of the family are now writing?
Well, I have a sister, Elizabeth, who is beginning to write. I've been writing for, I guess, about 5 years now. I'm venturing a guess, but I think one of the reasons he was able to survive as well as he did is because he did always have the prose, so that he could get involved with the quote-unquote business until he had his fill, and then go back to the short stories. And I think if you ration yourself, you're going to last a lot longer.
You know, when you tell me that, I can confirm that. But that's probably exactly the reason, because I must have told this 900 times. Your father had more of a pronounced effect on me when I came to this town than anybody, because the night that I got into town, and I literally arrived just after New Year's, mm-hmm. in 1962 with 10 cents. 10 cents is all I had. And the only person I knew in town was your father. And I called him, and I had barely enough gas to limp over to wherever the hell he was. He said, "I'll meet you at such and such a place." And we went and we shot pool in the valley. I like to shoot pool. And in the course of shooting that pool, he gave me the two best pieces of advice I have ever had about working in this industry. The first one was, we were talking about making better movies or making better television, getting on the inside and really making things better. And he said, "The secret of achieving success in Hollywood is," he says, "it's like climbing an enormous mountain of cow flop," mm-hmm. "so that you can pluck one perfect rose from the top." Mm-hmm. He said, "You find after you've made that hideous ascent, you have lost the sense of smell." And it was such a perfect image, which he was so good at, and I heeded that. The other one was, he said, "They don't understand the printed word. To them, it's like arcane runes." He said, "They look at you, if you have books and if you write stories, they look at you like a prince from a far land." And he said, "They treat you in a very different way than they treat the bought writers that they have every day, the whores, what they, you know, what they think of as whores." And he said, "Keep doing the stories, keep mm-hmm. doing the
yeah,
books."
Absolutely.
And he was absolutely right. And it's mm-hmm. Every year I've done a book or two, and it's hasn't gotten me any extra work. They still, you know, would rather hire Adolf Eichmann than me, but I kind of like it that way.
There is also the fact that I think there is an underlying fear in the business of what, I don't know, but I recall a story that when Chuck was, he was actually ill, and he went to see a pilot, and it was so bad that he got up and lunged to the fire door and just shouted, you know, a four-letter word at the top of his... you said you can say those words on this program, right?
Well,
or would you rather not?
Well, we can, but Bert, well, anyway. Bert Handelsman, our demon engineer, will have,
right.
an infarct.
French,
was it the F-word?
The French call it mirrored.
Oh, mirrored. Oh, the shit word. Oh, we can say that. That's all.
And anyway, he went out, screamed that word at the top of his lung, slammed the fire door so that the whole building shook, and went home. And then I recall he telephoned me and said, you know, "Well, I'm never going to work at this place again." At least he was convinced of that. But he said before he got home, the call was in from them, and they were saying, "What's wrong?
Yeah.
What's wrong?" And well, I think the best advice that he ever gave was two words, which he reduced to one, which he spelled S-C-R-O-O-M. With regard to the business, scroom.
Oh yeah, I was suddenly thinking of what's the where they have the scrim
in theaters.
What's in England the football game? Rugby, where they have a scrim.
Oh.
That's, I thought that's what you were spelling. I thought,
no.
What the hell is that? But
this
yeah.
game is much rougher.
Scrum.
Much rougher.
Yeah, scrum. No scrum rules. Is absolutely right. And the snake they slithered in on. It's probably painful to talk about a little bit, but can we talk about the death?
Sure.
Yeah. When Chuck got ill, he got ill very quickly, as I recall.
I don't know I'm how Chris feels about this, but my feeling in retrospect is that he was probably ill for a very long time, and that it was just progressive, that it was not noticeable until a later stage. Because the days, from the time I met him, he had these enormous headaches, and he would take enormous, inordinate amounts of bromo seltzer, which we always commented on and were always concerned about. And he always had trouble sleeping. He didn't like to eat. We'd go out to eat. He would order a big steak, and then he'd have a couple of bites and then leave it. So my feeling, and he was always underweight. He was like my height. He's like 6'2". He weighed about 140 pounds. So he was burning with energy, but he did not seem vibrant with health and my wife at any time. So my feeling is that it was not something that just came on suddenly to a perfectly healthy person. Now, I don't know how Chris feels about that.
I agree, and that's what made it so difficult to diagnose, because it wasn't a sudden change in behavior, because it affected him, I think, in small ways over the years. It was a slowly progressive thing, and so it was tough to, it would be very tough even now to establish a line of demarcation as to when he was well and when he was sick. It is a bizarre disease. And
No, he died of what? What was it called?
It was Alzheimer's.
It was Alzheimer's.
Yeah.
You see, I knew Chuck in Chicago, and when I came out here, I saw him a few times when I first came out, and then he was busy doing something, and I was struggling trying to stay alive, so I would see him only very rarely, and the last time I saw him before, I guess it hit fully, I saw him, and it was as if I was looking at a different person entirely, and then I would go out and see him at the motion picture home, and probably not a good thing to admit, but I just couldn't take it after a while. And it looked as if one of his own fantasies had attacked him. Mm-hmm. I mean, he was aging, so, you know, like 100 years in months.
In fact, that is exactly what he was doing. I mean, chronologically, he was 37, but physiologically, he was a man in his 90s. I mean, and looked it. So it was, as you say, it was almost as if it was out of a twilight zone.
Mm-hmm. I think the measure of the fact that it was cumulative and progressive is that the theory as to what was happening during it kept changing. At one point, I think everyone was convinced that he was an alcoholic, and that turned out not to be true. And then they said he had multiple sclerosis, and that turned out not to be true. And then I think it was Pick's disease. Something. At that time, Alzheimer's was almost unknown. Now it's very commonplace, but there was this producer who had worked on Twilight Zone, Bert Granit, and his mother, I think, had died of it. And then there was Chuck, and they were the only two cases that I'd ever heard of at that time.
Do you know, this week, speaking of Alzheimer's, they think they have found a breakthrough?
Really?
Yeah. I wish I'd brought in the piece, but they think they have isolated something in the DNA that that produces Alzheimer's.
Well, that's fabulous news. I remember at one point we sent him to the Mayo Clinic, which at that time, as today, but especially at that time, was absolutely the top of the line, and he was there for I think a week or 10 days, and went through every conceivable test, and they sent him back and said this man is in perfect health, and made it very difficult to establish what your next move is.
That's what the Mayo said about me too when I went there a few years ago. Yeah, I got a thing too, but it's not. I don't know, maybe it is Alzheimer's. Who the hell knows? I mean, the other day I was talking about the Mark of Zorro, and I could not remember Tyrone Power's name. Now, that's one of the you never, how can you ever forget Tyrone Power's name? And I get crazy.
Don Diego?
Yeah.
Well, that's because I watched it on TV.
I know in the course of the interviews I've done, a lot of the fellows, John Tomerlin, Jerry Sowell and whatnot, who...
How is Jerry?
He's doing okay. He's doing some mostly prose work, novels right now, and keeping very active. But some of their thoughts when this first became noticeable was, as you know, Chuck had juggled at various times in his career, would juggle as many as a dozen projects. He'd be working on a teleplay, something for Playboy, a piece for Rogue, he'd be working on a screenplay, and he would farm out the work to a lot of the guys, simply because he would either collaborate with them, plot it with them, do a first draft, they would polish or whatever, and then split the money with them. And as I understand it, most of the guys thought that perhaps it was just the stress and the strain of doing too much work, doing too much at one time. But as of course, as time went on, they realized that it was something much, much deeper than that.
That was one of the other theories then.
There was a time when I got out of the Army in 59, I got hired by Bill Hamling, who had begun his career working for Ziff Davis when they were in Chicago on Amazing and Fantastic. And when Ray Palmer, when Ziff Davis decided to move its offices to New York, Ray Palmer decided to stay in the area, and he started Other Worlds, a little science fiction magazine. And Bill Hamling began a science fiction magazine. Well, actually, Palmer started Imagination, then he sold it to Hamling. And as the years went by, Hamling was working at a place called Modern Man for a publisher named George von Rosen in Skokie, Illinois. And it was the first men's magazine before Playboy. In fact, and working in the accounting department of Modern Man was a guy named Hugh Hefner. And Hamling got to know Hefner. And Hefner took the cue from George von Rosen about this magazine, decided to start Playboy, which he did for, I guess, $700 on his kitchen table. And all of a sudden, he was a huge success. And Bill Hamling, who was doing these little dinky science fiction magazines, Bill Hamling burned with envy of a strange sort, because he wanted to be Hefner and never could be, because he didn't have that kind of talent and imagination and insight. But he started a magazine called Rogue, which was kind of a pulpish magazine for a while. And then when I got out of the Army, he had decided to go slick. And so I got hired, right, straight out of the U.S. Army Armor Center in Fort Knox, Kentucky, and I went to work for Bill Hamling. And Hamling sat there one night, one of the most bizarre human beings I have ever known. Some night we'll do a whole show on Bill Hamling, who wound up in prison in San Pedro, which is an interesting story too. And he said to me, he said, "I've got to have everybody who works for Hefner, they've got to work for me." He was so envious of the people. Well, of course, the people who were working for him at that time, there were a number of artists like Ron Bradford and writers like Herb Gold and Chuck Beaumont. And Hamling somehow met Chuck. Now, does anybody here know how Hamling met Chuck?
No, I have no idea.
Damn it, I'd love to be able to make that linkage. Mm-hmm. Well, that's how I met Chuck, mm-hmm. because Chuck kept turning him down at first. He didn't want to write for him, because if you wrote for anybody else and Hefner found out about it, Hefner would can you, and these people had...
I think Chuck was also, as I recall, on a monthly stipend from Playboy.
From Playboy,
$500,
right. Exactly. And Hefner was so insane about anybody else working for any other publication. There was some young woman who had posed for Playboy who also posed for Rogue. It was extra photos that were left over from the photo set. We used them. She was sent into Coventry, was never heard from again. I mean, they farmed her out to a white slave brothel in Marrakesh or something with bunny ears. And Chuck, I met and tried to con him into writing for Hamling. Hamling had met him somewhere, and he set up the meeting with us. And for the longest time, he wouldn't. And then he did. He did some sports car articles, and he did them under the name Robert Courtney. And he did kind of Hollywood articles under another house name. I can't remember what it was. But he didn't do any fiction, mm-hmm. until Hefner made the mistake of rejecting a story called The Howling Man. And Chuck called me and he said, "I got this story and Hefner's rejected it. You want to take a look at it?" And I said, "Yeah, send it over." Well, I mean, that story came in. I went out of my mind. It was one of the best stories I'd ever read, as anybody who's ever seen it on Twilight Zone knows. And that was how Chuck came to write fiction for us at Rogue, except we had to think of another name. So I said to him, what name do you want? Because we don't want to use, we want to build up another name. Mm-hmm. And he said, "Oh, I don't care, make up a name, you make it up." So I said, okay. So I said, okay, how can we do it so we don't get him in trouble and yet people will know it's Beaumont, so they'll know who it is. But, you know, I took the name Beaumont and corrupted the French into Love Hill. Mm-hmm. Which is not even close, but and the initial CB, CB Love Hill. And for some reason, Hefner never pieced it together, never figured it out. And Chuck did maybe 8 or 9 stories for us. And we started spending time together in Chicago, and he got me in a lot of trouble.
Did you ever get in trouble with your father?
Not serious trouble, no, no.
Well, how did you look on his madcap escapades, as we used to say in Hollywood?
Well, it made for a marvelously colorful childhood, and it is certainly one of the regrets that he didn't live, because I would love to get into some trouble with him, and I suspect if he would have lived, we would have gotten into some serious trouble.
he had an astonishing capacity for himself not getting in trouble, but everybody around him would get hit in the head with a bottle.
Uh-huh. Mm-hmm.
One night...
Just so you know, that doesn't pass on to the next generation.
Oh, you don't do that. Your resemblance is astonishing.
No, not the getting in trouble, but the managing to extricate one's... Yes, yes.
So all around you fall dead while you walk around. I mean, good to know, Beaumont. One night, he said, he called me up, and I was living in Evanston, and he said, I want you to meet somebody. I want you to come with me this evening. I said, okay, well, who is it? He said, you'll see. Well, the person he wanted me to meet was Ian Fleming, and who was already a huge star. And here was Ian Fleming in this Savile Row suit, and your old man, who was a hot dresser, and I looked like a bumpkin, for Christ's sake. I always look like a bumpkin, and of course I'm 4'4". And they took me to a sports car bar called the Bucket Seat, which was run by one of the most knockout-looking women you ever saw in your life. But she would only get involved with guys who raced sports cars. I was driving, I don't know, a Ford or some crap like that. I don't know what it was, a bucket of bolts. And your father and Fleming, we were all three sitting at the bar, and I don't even drink. I was drinking Perrier mineral water or something like that. Both of them really ran their numbers on this woman. And they were so smooth and so slick. And I thought, oh, God, you know, if I just had a little of that oil, I could be God, you know? I wound up living with that woman. And your father called me one day, and he said, how did you do that? And I said, damned if I know. But that was one of the most memorable evenings of my life. I think it kept me going for about 6 years. I wound up, however, getting into sports cars because of that. And your father and this woman decided that I should drive an Austin Healey.
Oh, I'm sorry.
And they picked out for me a gunmetal blue Austin Healey, a Monza. Mm-hmm. And I wound up racing it, mm-hmm, and did not too badly. Didn't do all that well either, but not badly. And at Watkins Glen, broke both my legs. Spun out on the S's and tipped over, and a couple of hay bales saved my life. Both legs were broken. I thought, screw you, Chuck Beaumont. You go be Zorro. I'm going to stay alive, thank you.
Don Diego.
Didn't Chuck Beaumont once talk you, Dick, into buying a
sports
car?
Never. No, he tried, though, didn't he? The dedication
lies,
to omnibus of speed has Chad's name, and I forget who else, but I'm one of them. And the dedication is to so-and-so-and-so and Richard Matheson, whose steadfast misunderstanding of motorsports has spurred us to the task.
Well, did he impart his love of jazz to you?
Oh, yeah, he exposed me to an awful lot of things, which I found fascinating. I mean, I always liked music.
Did Penicillin cure any of those exposures?
No, he would forever, he'd say, you've got to see this movie, or you've got to... he dragged us to see Chico Hamilton's quintet once, I remember, which I thought was wonderful. And he
was Freddie Katz playing with him then, do you remember?
I don't know. I don't remember. And he would take us to a play, or he would come and drag us out to play ping pong or something. And very stimulating. I was thinking about it the other day when in regard to this program, and thinking that almost never does a person have come into their life someone who is so dazzling and so coruscating and so effervescent that they just are a marvel to behold in every respect. You just don't have friends like that. And Chuck was like that in our life. You would just sort of blink and he'd be gone, and he'd say, I must go to Iceland or something, and he'd be gone, you know. But
he was the perfect visiting uncle.
Yeah, he was one. He would call me on the phone and say, "Methusen, this then is I," and then he would proceed with the conversation, whatever it had to do.
Well, I listened to a tape the other day. It was Chuck Beaumont and John Tomerlin and Bill Nolan would get together frequently and write these sketches, complete with sound effects and whatnot, and record them on this tape recorder. And they would write their own shows, make their own commercials and everything just for kicks. And in this one particular tape dealt with the fact that Dick Matheson was considering moving to Mexico. And Chuck Beaumont tried just as hard as he could to talk him out of it and said, "No, don't go there. You don't know what you're in for. You know, we'll never ever see you again. You know, you'll just vanish off the face of the earth." And Chuck was so concerned that the Mathesons were going to Mexico, he and Tomerlin and Nolan and some of the others got together and wrote a sketch called "The Mathesons in Mexico." And had them
caught by rurales and bandidos.
Exactly.
And I don't get to show you no stinking badges.
As I recall, the last line is this Mexican bandit coming up and say, "Here is the head of the family."
And it was the funniest thing. And the energy that he put into anything he did. And he was...
Reading the stories, you know, I guess the most recent of these stories is, what, 20 years,
mm-hmm.
20 years old already. It's as if they just came out of the typewriter. Mm-hmm. There isn't a line that's awkward in any mm-hmm. of them. Did he, was he a natural talent? What was his background in writing?
Well, I don't know what constitutes a natural talent. He worked very, very hard. And his background, as far as I know, always wanted to be a writer. Although I know he did spend some time as an actor, I get the sense that the reason that didn't work out is because I think that I think it was a sidebar. I think that he really always wanted to write and that he was writing in one form or another since he was a teenager. And in fact, started to actually get down to the brass tacks of writing when he was 19 or 20.
Mm-hmm.
And I think had an incredible sense of discipline and knew more than most how much actual hard work goes into it. Seemed to know that instinctively. And it's just been, I remember the nights that I wasn't kept awake by the laughter of the group, actually before the group actually got together and coalesced into a regular meeting, I remember going to sleep to the sound of the typewriter. That is my memory of going to sleep as a child, was the typewriter.
No wonder you turned into a writer night after night.
Yeah. In fact, I think when Chuck had written some autobiographical sketches on himself, and in one of them...
Let me break in one second, Roger. This is KPFK Los Angeles, 90.7 on the FM dial. This is Mike Hodel's Hour 25. I'm your host, Harlan Ellison. My guests tonight on this Chuck Beaumont 20th Anniversary Memorial Show are Richard Matheson, Roger Anker, and Chris Beaumont. Go ahead, Roger.
When Chuck was 12, he was bedridden for several months with spinal meningitis. And he claims that it was at this time in his life that he had discovered literature. And I'd like to read something he had written, and it goes something like this. He said, "Football, baseball, and dime store cookie thefts filled my early world to the exclusion of Aesop, the Brothers Grimm, Dr. Doolittle, and even Bullfinch. The installation by my parents of library wallpaper in the house, a room full of books for only 70 cents a yard, convinced me that literature was on the way out anyway. So I lived in illiterate contentment until laid low by spinal meningitis. This forced me to less strenuous forms of entertainment. I discovered Oz, then Burroughs, then Poe, and the jig was up. Have been reading ever since, feeling no pain."
What, didn't he play football too? He was so tall. Mm-hmm. I imagine the after result of the spinal meningitis was the fact that he became so lean.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
as I'm sure gathered, you're right. He was pretty bulky when he was young.
Certainly bulkier. That's not hard to do. But actually, I think that other than the sports car racing, which he loved dearly and absolutely was a great release, physical sports were frowned upon.
Ping pong,
and we moved into a house at one point that had a badminton court, and he had never played badminton, and absolutely fell in love. So we played a lot of badminton, if you can call that a physical sport.
I remember the first time I ever saw him, I thought he was a Martian, because he was very tall, and he had a very, I don't know, the receding hair, he had that prematurely gray hair, and that very large domed forehead, and I thought, wow, that's exactly what a Martian should look like. And then he said bizarre things to me, and I knew he was a Martian. It was all very strange.
Now, wasn't he studying or thinking of becoming a concert pianist at one time?
Absolutely, yeah. And there was always loads and loads of music in the house, and some of it played by him. There was always a piano in the house, even when we were living in very small apartments, and the piano took up an inordinate amount of space.
Right.
And he would play. He would tinker. I mean, he again that became a release. Although he played very well.
And, he did.
He
did cartooning too. Didn't he work for cartoon?
He was in the Mickey Mouse animation department at MGM for a while.
Yeah.
Inking cartoons for that.
Yeah.
Who didn't Chuck like? Who if the name came up, as earlier tonight a name came up, who did he ever say a bad word about? Was there anybody, can you remember?
No, I don't know. Never in a lasting way. I mean, he would have a fit or a snit or something and curse someone to damnation, but...
Well, producers don't count. Producers don't count.
Well,
those are not human beings we're talking about
that
there.
That cuts the list down.
I never heard him say a bad word about anybody.
No.
You know,
ever.
In all the interviews I have done, and it sums up to about 120-some-odd hours worth of taped interviews, I have never heard that come up ever from anyone. And I can honestly say that I've never heard anyone say anything bad about Chuck.
No, that's...
Most people considered Charles Beaumont the best friend they ever had. And I realized that Chuck Beaumont had, you know, at least a dozen solid best friends. And I think a lot of it was his ability to see something in everyone, and to be able to identify with it, whether it would be that if your interest lied in being a pianist and it was music, you know, he was able to take that up, or race car driving or writing or acting or whatever.
I always thought of the word charismatic in connection with your father. Now look, Chris has got to leave here. You need an extra time?
No, I've got about another 10 minutes.
Another 10 minutes, okay. Yeah. He's going to be on a plane to New York and came in tonight to do this show. There was the strange capacity on his part to be, as you say, you know, one of those people who comes into your life and it just dominates everything. You know, you meet somebody like that every once in a while. Sam Peckinpah was like that, and Jean Rhys I met once. She was like that in London. And Chuck, no matter what room he came into, and no matter who was in the room, I mean, it could have been the entire cast from Oz. He still would have been the wizard.
I have known people like that who have functioned that way on a certain level within their work or within their circle of friends. One in a long list of remarkable things about him was that he included his family in that, and my mother and my sisters and my brother, certainly to a lesser extent my siblings, but had a chance to experience that. And a lot of people who exude that, sometimes it is at the expense of one group or another. And I can't think of a group that did get excluded.
Boy, are you lucky.
Yes.
You're really lucky.
Very lucky.
I keep hearkening about trying to find my father. I mean, my father died when I was, 14, 15, something like that.
Mm-hmm.
And I keep looking for him still in my stories. I keep writing these damn stories in which I find my father. And I must admit that I envy you considerably to have those stories all, you know, around you at all, coming out at all that time.
No, I think it would be a fascinating study to have an analysis made of all his stories together to get a sort of a psychological profile of how his mind was working through all those years, because I think you can find out exactly what a writer was going through and what they were, you know, as a person during the time they were creating, just on the basis of their stories and how the attitudes change, mm-hmm. how the style changes, everything mm-hmm. about it. And I think that would be a very interesting thing to do with Chuck's stories.
Even the output, even the volume of output, it is almost as if he knew somewhere, although he was never conscious of being of suffering a disease. He was never conscious of that, but it is as if somewhere he knew that his time was short, and hence a remarkable output mm-hmm. for a relatively short amount of years. Short number of years, he produced right. an incredible amount of work.
His career really didn't get start until about 1950, and when the Alzheimer's really took effect was, most people say his last good year was probably towards the end of 1963. So in that span of time, he managed to write and sell approximately 12 screenplays, about 70-some-odd short stories, about 70 teleplays, two novels. He edited two books on automobile racing, edited one anthology.
What's the other novel?
Wrote Run from the Hunter.
That's right.
It's a novel that he had wrote in collaboration with John Tomerlin.
Was it published?
Yes, it was, and it's under the pseudonym of Keith Grantland.
Aha!
Keith is Chris's middle name.
Ah, now they tell me. Oh, boy. Oh, boy. I got another one I haven't read. Oh, boy. That's it. Well,
we'll get you a copy.
Folks, good night. This has been my... That's all I need for this program. The hell with the rest of you.
And he did several... he was writing a regular column for a fantasy and science fiction magazine, doing a film column.
Film column.
Called The Science Screen.
Mm-hmm. God, I just remembered that. God, that's amazing. Now that's what I'm doing. I write the film column now.
Right.
That's eerie. Good Lord, I'm becoming your father.
when you take into consideration all this was done in between, you know, just...
13 years?
13 years. It's just really
not funny. To mention all the articles that he was writing. I mean, he wrote right. a lot of articles, the nostalgia pieces, all the stuff for Playboy. Well, who got into Corman first? Was it you, Richard, or was it Chuck?
I guess it was me doing the Fall of the House of Usher. And then later on, he and Ray Russell did a picture for him, a premature burial, I guess. And yeah. Then they were working. I think Chuck worked on the
Right. Well, Chuck's first picture for Roger Corman was The Intruder.
It was. Oh, really?
And that was released in 1962, of which Chuck had an acting role. He played the high school principal. And
that was on the. I was telling people last week. It was on some ungodly hour.
A different title, I think.
Right, Under Shame.
Yeah, Shame.
Yeah, right.
And then he did Burn Witch Burn with Dick
Yeah,
Matheson,
that's right, we collaborated.
Which was also
I'll tell you about that.
62. Then Premature Burial with Ray Russell, which was out in 62. And then The Haunted Palace, which was out in 1963.
What year was Mr. Moses?
Mr. Moses was released in 1965. That was his last screenplay.
Yeah, not a terrific movie. Brothers Grimm, I always liked Brothers Grimm. Mm-hmm. That's somehow tied up in some kind of litigation. They won't let it out. They won't let it be released.
Yeah, they showed it on television a few months ago and taped it.
Really?
Yeah.
Why
yeah.
do I keep missing these things?
And well, it was amazing what he
you
did.
You're sitting there laughing at me. Come on.
It's amazing what he did with the Circus of Dr. Lau, too, which is a magnificent book, but has no story that you can follow, whatever. And that Chuck was able to turn it into a story that you could follow as a film and he did it, I think, while he was working on the Wonderful World of the Brothers Grimm. I think he did it in about a week or so while he wasn't even paid for it. He incidentally, I guess, made up the phrase "the wonderful world of," which they used to absolute extinction after a while. Mm-hmm.
Did you ever have you ever noticed? Not I'm not suggesting anything here, but except to note the similarity. You ever notice the similarity between Chuck's version of The Circus of Dr. Lau and the film version of Ray Bradbury's Something Wicked This Way Comes?
Well, that would only be because The Circus of Dr. Lau was written first, the book.
Well, I know,
but... It was about a circus, a strange circus coming to this small town, so...
I'm talking about there's a strange, interesting view of morality.
Oh.
That shows in both of them. Of course, having Tony Randall play 92 parts in your film is not too dusty either. Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's a lovely film.
Is there a story about Burn Witch Burn?
Oh, yeah. Well, Chuck and I wanted to do something together. I mean, we went to a bar one night. We were eating hard-boiled eggs and drinking beer, and we thought, well, what'll we do? And we thought, well, gee, we really like the novel Conjure Wife by Fritz Leiber. But we knew that Universal owned it, and that they'd already made a film out of it called Weird Woman with Lon Chaney Jr. But we ignored reality totally, and we made a screenplay out of it together. I wrote the first half, he wrote the second half, and then we just joined it together and patched it all up. And American International bought it, and because Universal did own it, and they had to buy it from Universal. Chuck and I think, got about 35 cents for the whole thing. But we had the pleasure of seeing it made in England and done rather well. So
done very well.
It's yeah.
Oh, lovely. It's a lovely film.
Lovely film.
Yeah. Lovely film. Janet...
The singer, yeah. Janet. Oh, dear.
Janet Lee?
No. Janet...
That's
big
right.
Star in the 40s.
Musical star.
Janet.
Roger's gone to his notes. We will know Roger, in a moment.
Janet, he will tell us in a minute.
Yeah, and I think, hey, I can remember the director, Sidney Ayers.
they shot it in England, didn't they?
Oh, yes, yes. And the man who played the ghost in Turn of the Screw was played the hero, Peter or something, his name.
Very, very good film.
It was.
Really holds up. I saw it not too long ago, and it holds up just wonderfully.
Yeah, and it follows our script very, very closely.
I must go, but I certainly want to thank you.
Hey, thank you.
For this evening.
It's been very strange seeing you. I mean, you look so much like your old man that we'll
talk again.
Come hit the house. We'll sit and have some coffee.
Okay.
Thanks, Chris.
Have a good tip, Chris.
Chris Beaumont will now vanish in a puff of smoke, even as his father did so frequently, and leaving the stench of charisma behind. And
just so this won't keep you up on the plane, the name is Janet Blair.
Janet Blair.
Janet Blair.
I knew
Janet
that. She was. You go for your notes.
Gorgeous redhead.
Once I put my son in the empty chair, he remembers Chuck too.
All right, Richard Christian, come on, schlep yourself in here, and you can take over for Chris. We will now have two generations of Mathesons in here. I always feel awkward talking to anyone whose name is Richard Christian. But we better close the outside door too, otherwise we'll the ravening hordes who come in here every Friday night to be here for the show. They also eat all the hors d'oeuvres. I find that very difficult.
Hi.
Joining us around the Onyx table is what are you laughing, Schmendrick? Don't do that.
Is this Onyx?
Of course, it's Onyx.
Outdoor Onyx.
Hey, this is the massive underground, cadmium and aluminum ballroom of here at KPFK.
That's nice.
And this is where we have our dances. This is where we have.
I see a balloon up at the ceiling.
That's what left over from from the Whitsuntide celebration.
It's very festive.
It was AstroTurf.
Richard Christian. Is that how you wish to be addressed?
Sure, yeah, you can call me R.C. It's quicker than
R.C. is quicker.
Yeah.
Tell us something we don't know already about Chuck.
I remembered that Chuck, when he would go swimming, had a inflatable, like a flotation thing that he used because he was embarrassed that he didn't know how to swim. But he had a swimming pool at his house. Do you remember that?
Not that you mentioned it, yeah.
Yeah, I thought that was the strangest thing. It was like some weird device from another world or something, and he would... And it was like a
balloon?
Yeah,
rubber tire kind of thing.
Yeah, yeah, and he would put it in. It wasn't bulky or anything. I mean, it didn't look like he had, you know, anything funny, but he would do that. I remember he had a butler's bell at this house, you know, like on underneath the table, and it was really something. It was like an estate. And I remember Chris had this incredible treehouse that Chuck had given him the financing.
That was out in the valley.
Yeah, right.
Yeah.
Yes, that's right.
It was the house on the corner.
Yeah, lived next door to Bernard Herrmann, the composer.
And also
Al
Lewis.
Remember the treehouse?
Remember Al Lewis would wander down, Grandpa, from
that's
the Munsters.
Right. Yeah, right. That was a beautiful house.
But this treehouse that Chris had was like a condominium.
Chris had a race car, too, didn't he?
He had a midget racer.
Yeah.
Do you know, I never met any of those people. I mean, I only met Helen a couple of times. It was as if Chuck was ashamed of me, you know. I think I was in the house only once. There was no one else around.
I get the impression he wasn't in town for lengths of time. I mean, that he would, was that true that he would come in and out of town?
Now that you mentioned Helen, I think something should be said about her because she was a wonderful woman and a wonderful wife and mother to Chris. My wife and I always were extremely close to her. And
she died very soon after
Chuck. She died within a few years.
1971.
Yeah, of cancer. And it was just tragic.
I remember her being very remarkably warm and, really kind.
Well, now that he's gone, talk about Chris raising the family, because they've made, what, two movies about it?
Mm.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah, well, it was really incredible that what they did. My wife and I were legally their foster parents for a while, and I would go to the bank with them and help them with their finances, and there was talk for a while of us trying to incorporate them in our family. Since we had four children in limited space, it was a very difficult thing to do. And then there was also talk about splitting them up, since Helen, Chuck's wife, had so many brothers. They were each going to take one of the children, and Chris didn't want to do this. And so with the help...
Chris was how old?
Really young, about 18, maybe.
18, 19, yeah.
17,
and
18.
And with the help of Reuben...
Carson.
Reuben Carson, who was a neighbor.
God, I never knew Reuben was involved.
He and his wife were very, very close to them and overlooked them and watched over them. And somehow, in this incredible way, in this house where there were no parents, Chris became, in essence, the father. And his younger sister, Elizabeth, in a sense, became the mother of the family. And they somehow managed to pull it off. I mean, at great cost, at great emotional cost, I think, especially to Chris, because it's a ghastly thing for anyone to have to do. And we tried to help him as often as possible. We had a place up at Arrowhead at the time, and we would take the younger children with us for weekends or for a week at a time, and to give him a little freedom. But no matter what you did, it was just a tremendously difficult period for him to go through.
What happened to that house? Are they still in there? Anybody still?
They went through a succession of houses. They moved out to Malibu for a while, and everybody kind of went their own ways. Gregory moved up to Santa Cruz, I think.
Yeah. Well, he's back now.
Is he back now?
Yeah. Yeah, they're all grown now, and remarkable in their strengths, considering what they had to go through.
Chris is the most incredible man I've ever met, I think. You know, to have done what he did. He never, let on what was going on. I mean, he never, I don't know how he would have looked for sympathy. I don't know what sympathy would have done, but he never looked for any. He was always remarkably cheerful. As nurturing as he could be to those kids. He was funny. I mean, he was always funny and up. And
there couldn't have been a lot of money coming into the house. I mean, because except from the Twilight Zones, I guess.
Well, there was. They had an insurance man named Ari Sinagnos who, when at a certain point, when I think when they were having financial problems and Chuck was not paying the premiums on it, on this insurance policy. And Agnos paid them on his own because he's really a marvelous man himself, and the money from this insurance was what, on a monthly basis was what kept them, plus their mothers, was what kept them going. It was not an enormous sum, but it kept them going at a time so that they didn't have to work.
Hmm. Something peculiar. Beaumont stuff is. As the listeners heard, is really remarkable stuff. I mean, there is not a bad story in his canon.
No. That short story you read was just dazzling.
and that's that's just a short one. I mean, to read The Howling Man or Miss Gentlebell,
Black Country is
still a knockout. Yeah. Why in a field that doesn't seem to forget anybody? I mean, you can still get Ed Earl Repp books, they're published by Ballantyne. Why have Chuck's stories not taken hold? Why are they not?
Well, my feeling is that it's very simple, and that is that they do not fall into any category. They're called fantasies, but many of his stories were not fantasies. Mm-hmm. He didn't really write much science fiction. He wrote stories of an unusual, bizarre, sometimes grotesque, always imaginative nature. But they were not strict fantasy or strict science fiction. Therefore, they did not fall into the genre in a secure place. And I think, I don't know what Roger thinks, but that's what I feel about it.
Well, I have a book coming out this July. It's going to be a collection of Chuck's stories. And there'll be about 30 stories in the book. It's coming out from Dark Harvest Press. And what I've done to make this book special and as insightful to Chuck as I could was I've asked as many of Chuck's closest friends and co-workers to write introductions for each story. And the response was just wonderful. I've got right now 23 introductions. Dick Matheson did an introduction, for instance, for Last Rites Harlan. Of course, you did one for The Howling Man. Hugh Hefner did one for me for Perchance to Dream. Ray Bradbury did one for Miss Gentle Bell. Bill Nolan, A Death in the Country, and so on down the line. And I've also...
adequate proof that he had no enemies.
Right. Yeah. Mm. And I've... Chad Oliver, of course, is in Texas. Chuck Beaumont and Chad Oliver had done what they called the Claude stories, I, Claude, mm-hmm. Guess of Chance, and whatnot. And in 1955, they were planning another Claude story, which was to have been their last Claude story, which was going to be titled To Hell with Claude. And they plotted it all out, got everything down on notes, and Beaumont says, I will write the first half of it, and I'll turn it over to you. And he did this, and he wrote 14 pages and mailed it to Chad. Well, for one reason or another, the story never got finished. And recently, because of this book and my speaking with Chad, Chad finished the story and wrote an introduction to it, which the introduction actually reads like a letter to Chuck. It's a very touching introduction, a wildly funny story, one of the funniest things I've ever read. And again, the book will be out this July.
What are you calling it? As if I didn't know.
Well, there's a tentative title. One was to go with The Touch of the Creature, which was a collection that Chuck was planning at the time he got sick, and from Bantam, which never got put out, or just simply Charles Beaumont Collected Stories.
Call it A Touch of the Creature. Come on, God, Anchor, I can't understand why you keep fighting that. It's a great title.
It is.
A great title.
But there will also be, just to sum this up, three other previously unpublished stories that I've got about a dozen of Chuck's stories that were not published, that some were going to be in Touch of the Creature that will be included in this book.
Were there more that weren't published, or was it about a dozen?
It was about a dozen, and I'm planning a subsequent volume of unpublished stuff.
When the book gets closer to publication date, let us know, and we will start pushing it very hard for you. Because there's nobody out there who thinks he knows what writing is, who knows what writing is until he's read Beaumont.
It's evidential of the field that the ones who get the biggest name, I think, are the ones who stay within a certain genre and don't stray too far. And I think Chuck strayed in all directions. He did it wonderfully every time he strayed.
Yeah.
But in straying, you disseminate the followership, people who say, oh yeah, you are such and such a writer.
If it hadn't been for Playboy, I suspect Chuck would not have been as well known as he was, because that was his market.
Yeah, that's true.
This was his big break in 1954. His first short story sale there was Black Country.
Yeah. Then he did Red Beans and Rice Liers.
Right.
And then The Crooked Man.
Right.
And that was, for those of you out there who don't know about The Crooked Man, that's one of the great stories. Chuck wrote, let's see, how do we explain The Crooked Man? In a world of homophobia, which is what the 50s were, Chuck wrote this incredible, it was the first story that I'd ever read in which homosexuality was treated that openly, and it's a future society in which everybody is homosexual, and it's about a guy meeting a woman in a bar, and they're arrested for evil sex, which is heterosexual sex.
And they get caught.
And they get caught.
And they get caught, and what they do is they bring you in and work on your mind.
Yeah.
The tagline to the end of that story was, "Don't worry, sir, we'll make a new man of you."
Yeah. and it's such a strange homophobic rewrite of Orwell.
Mm-hmm.
And absolutely a knockout piece. I remember, it's been years since I read it, but I remember very well, the guy comes into the bar to meet the woman, and there are guys dancing with each other, which at that time was, you know, just unheard of. And the waiter comes up to him, and he's wearing leathers. I mean, Chuck foresaw all this stuff, man.
Mm-hmm.
The guy is wearing leathers, and he begins... He does the finger dance.
Mm-hmm.
There's a finger dance, which is a kind of a come on.
Yep.
And of course, Chuck submitted this story to Esquire because he wanted to be an Esquire very badly, mm-hmm. and Esquire bounced it.
Mm. Well, they bought it at first. They took it.
Well, they did take it.
And they were going to run it, and then they had second thoughts on it and thought it was just a bit too much. And at the last minute, they turned it down.
Yeah.
And then Chuck went with it.
Well, it became a cause célèbre, and of course, Hefner, being sharp, picked it up instantly, right. And we just ran for that issue of Playboy. I was in college at the time, and I ran for it, and I read this thing, and my hair stood on end.
Mm-hmm.
And the amazing thing about the way Chuck wrote is it's like Fred Astaire dancing. It looks so goddamn simple.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And you try it yourself, and you say, wait a minute, how did he do that?
Exactly. It's like this hallucination on paper.
Oh, it's incredible. Did he do a lot of rewriting, or did it just come out of him?
I don't know. You get the impression that it just came flooding out of
really
his typewriter,
is.
But I'm sure he... Well, I remember seeing him and seeing pencil scrawls and pen scrawls over his manuscripts, obviously, and Chris said he worked very hard on it.
Mm-hmm.
Obviously, it didn't just come spilling out word
well,
for word.
Well, looking through the files, Chuck kept... everything that had anything to do with any story he was working on. He had every draft of every story, the places he would submit it, any letters of correspondence between the publishers, and for the most part, I would say the average drafts he did on per story was about 3.
Really?
Wow.
He was a very, very, very fast writer.
Maybe.
Very, very quick.
Mm-hmm. I remember the night that the group of us were at his apartment and he read us Black Country.
Mm-hmm.
And it was quite an experience. I mean, it's a long story, and it was just absolute dead silence. And when it was all over, we just sort of didn't say anything. We just sort of gasped. Or we didn't know what to say. It was so impressive.
Mm-hmm. He burst on the. I mean, he was a real phenomenon for a while there, because Playboy, for those of us who knew what was happening, Playboy was the place to be looking.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, the New Yorker was still publishing Tired Fiction then, and the Atlantic and all the rest of them. Well, you know, they were all doing the same kind of mainstream craps, you know, imitation Faulkner and post Steinbecki and stuff, and Hemingway,
mm-hmm.
Monquet stuff. And here was Playboy. It was publishing this really muscular fiction,
mm-hmm.
Good solid plotting and story. And you, Dick, you were doing The Splendid Source was around that time.
Mm-hmm.
And
The Distributor.
The Distributor. Mm-hmm. Oh God, that's what I. People still talk about that. I say, have you ever read the story about where the dirty jokes come from?
Oh yeah,
so funny.
Amazing. So what it must have been sensational to be part of that whole crowd.
Yeah. Well, as I say, you never realize at the time you enjoy it. It's only in retrospect that you know you realize what was going on. I think that's probably true. Hemingway and all his friends in Paris were not thinking about that they were going to be immortals. They were just getting drunk and having fun and writing books.
You weren't aware of being on the cutting edge at all. I mean, that you guys were.
No, I never know. I think Robert Kirsch sort of indicated something about us, and we were the Hollywood.
Yeah.
He called it the West Coast group of writers.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But boy, you were having an amazing effect on the rest of. I mean, you particularly when Born of Man and Woman hit. I mean, people went out of their Mesopotamian minds. We were running around in small circles saying, who the hell is this guy? And then Witch War. And
yeah.
I want to read you this thing about when Chuck wrote Queen of Outer Space.
Well, now, this is the thing that Hamley said, that many of his stories were adapted for Twilight Zone. No one, he adapted his own stories and did his own script. That makes it sound like someone else wrote them. Mm-hmm. Chuck did the scripts and everything.
Oh, he never let anybody touch his work but himself?
No, not until later on when he was, you know, very ill and people were helping him with the script. Oh, no, he did everything. And speaking of speed, I can remember occasions when they would be looking for a script on Monday morning, and Sunday afternoon he'd say, oh, gee, I got to get started. And he'd have it in by Monday morning,
yeah.
And they'd shoot it, and it was great.
Queen of Outer Space, Bill Warren, talking about this film, says, this flashily titled film has some oddities in the credits. The original story is credited to Ben Hecht. The script is by Charles Beaumont, and a leading role, though not the title character, is played by Zsa Zsa Gabor, Miss Hungary of 1936. This strange salad of famous names doesn't result in a good film, although Queen of Outer Space does have some interest. And then it goes on, and Bill Warren does one of his incomparable praises of the plot, which is more unbelievable than you can imagine. The producer was a guy named... I guess it's pronounced Burns. Mm. I don't know, Burns. Burns. Edward Burns.
Oh, Edward Burns, yeah.
It says here...
Ed Cookie Burns?
They're no, talking here are. About... of course, Ben Hecht also slumped from time to time in some of his films, such as The Goldwyn Follies, 37, Miracle of the Bells, 1948, and Circus World, 1964, were anything but distinguished. By the early 50s, Hecht's movie scripts were fewer and farther between. Edward Burns, who directed Queen, told interviewer Tom Weaver in Fantastic Films number 37 that Hecht's contribution was a 10-page outline, a satire on women ineptly in charge of another planet. It goes on and on and on and on and on. According to Burns, Walter Wanger thought that his wife, Joan Bennett, might be having an affair with her agent, so he shot the agent in the crotch. Wanger was out in a year or so. He needed it. I worked for Walter Wanger just before he died. Well, yeah, on we were doing
some part of a restaurant on Sunset Strip, wasn't it?
Right.
Parking lot.
That's
shot
right.
Him in the crotch.
Shot him in the crotch.
Really?
Thought his old lady was having it off with this agent.
Wow.
Shot in the crotch.
I mean, I don't know which offended him more, that she was having an affair or that she was having an affair with an agent.
So he took 10%.
Good, good. Good, I see, good.
Maybe 5%.
Wanger was the dearest man. He was a very nice man. I was working at Metro, working for him on a film that was based on a mystery story called Swing Low, Sweet Harriet, which is about two cops who were gay. And I was going to write it for. We were writing it for. Barry Shear was going to direct. Barry Shear is now dead, also. And we were going to write it for Sidney Poitier and Paul Newman to play a couple of gay private investigators. And at that point, Metro had somehow lost all its business. I mean, this was just after the period of Man from U.N.C.L.E. and all that good stuff. And I was working in the Thalberg Building, great, beautiful building. Mm. And it was so dead, it was so empty, that in the afternoons, when I get done writing my pages, I would take a bowling ball and roll it down the hall. I would roll it all the way down. And the only other person who was working there was Gabe, not Gabe Katzke, who the hell's the producer who did Marlowe?
Bill?
No, God, he worked for Gabe. It was Gabe Katzke. It was an embassy flick. And I can't remember who the guy... Oh, that's a shame, because he's still making films. He makes good films, too. And we would... oh, God, what a weird time, though. I'm just... All this crap is flowing back. I would go down there and play gin rummy with him all afternoon. He was a sweet guy, but the biggest patsy in the world. I was making more at a half a cent a point gin rummy with him than I was making on salary. And I was making a good salary. And one day... This has nothing to do with Chuck, but this is one of these strange old Hollywood stories. One day, they came in and said to him, "Hey, we got the dailies, the rushes. We got the rushes ready to look at." And he says, "Come on down with me. Come with me. You got anything else?" I said, "No, I'm done working for today. I did three pages. You know, they figured I could have done 40, but they didn't know that. So I do three pages. You know, I'm on a week to week. What the hell? I'm getting fat." On that, so we go down and look at the dailies, and it was the film Marlowe, and the stuff they were showing us that day was Bruce Lee, and I'd never heard of Bruce Lee. I didn't know who Bruce Lee was, and the scene was I'm not even sure if it's in the final film, but it was an overhead shot of Bruce running across through a warehouse with packing crates and all, and. They ran the thing,
And all you could see was, so help me God, a blur of blue light. I mean, pyong! And I'm trying to remember who the producer, this guy, this producer says, okay, who's being funny? You know, who undercranked? And behind us, the assistant director, the DA, was sitting there, and he said, that's normal speed, sir. Now, he wouldn't believe it. He said, don't pull my... He got really furious about it. He was angry because the film was going over budget, and he was paying James Garner a fortune, and he was got angry, and he said... So he saw all the takes on it, and every take was Lee just... I mean, it was like a bullet fired out of a gun, and he said, somebody is jiving me here, and I want to, you know. And he got so angry, he went down to the set, and here was Bruce Lee doing this, you know, other scenes from the film, and he said, I want to see you run. He said, I want to see you run because they're jerking me off here. So Bruce, who I was seeing for the first time, who was about my height, said to him, why can't I think of his name? This is, I'm afraid I'm getting Alzheimer's. He said to this guy who was very tall. He was about, I don't know. Well, to me, 5'7" is tall, but he was well over 6 feet. He was about 6'5", something like that. He said to him, "I will show you how fast I run, but you must do exactly as I say." So the guy said, "Yeah." He said, "Stand here." Now, they can't see this on the radio, but I'm taking the equivalent of two small Perrier bottles, and I'm standing one on top of the other, and I am taking this all-purpose Swiss Army knife.
He's really doing this.
Now, picture this in comparison to each other. How tall would you say these bottles are?
Well, maybe a foot.
6'5".
They're 6'5". Bruce was about my height, about 5'4", 5'5", something like that. And he said to the guy, he said, "Whatever you do, do not move." He said, "Do you understand?" He said, yeah, "don't move, don't move." He said, "Really, don't move." Bruce went back about 65, 70 feet in this warehouse thing, and he started to run. From a dead start, he must have been hitting 80 by the time he got to this guy, and Bruce stepped over him.
Whoa.
He rose straight up in the air, went over him like a croquet wicket, came down on the other side, and continued running. Virtually without breaking stride. It was an astonishing thing to see. The producer fainted dead away like that. His eyes rolled up in his head, and bam, down he went. And they had to do special effects on all of Bruce Lee's stuff. They had to slow it down.
Wow.
And that was the first time I ever saw Bruce Lee. I said, this is amazing.
As I recall, didn't they end up killing off Bruce Lee? Didn't he jump off a patio in almost the first scene of the picture?
Exactly. He well, there's a scene where he comes in and he destroys Garner's office.
That's right.
One of the smashes the desk in half, of course, which was a prop desk. But he kicked. He did a kick, an overhead kick, and knocked out the overhead light.
I remember that.
And then it was, and that was not too much fake. Anyhow, to get back to this stupid movie, according to Burns, Walter Wanger thought that his wife Joan Bennett might be having an affair with her agent, so he shot the agent in the crotch. Wanger was out in a year or so. He needed a job, but the big studios didn't want to give him a break. The president of Allied Artists finally did hire him, and Walter Wanger came to AA as a producer. He brought with him a 10-page outline by Ben Heck called Queen of the Universe. Burns says, "I don't know how Ben Schwalb came to produce the picture instead of Wanger, but that's what happened." This seems accurate. As early as 1951, the New York Times, July 15th, Wanger announced that he was about to produce Queen of the Universe from a story by Ben Hecht, a, quote, speculation on life on the planet Venus when the world is being properly run by women. The only author credited for the final script, though, is Charles Beaumont. In the notes on Abbott and Costello Go to Mars in Volume 1, Bill Warren related the story that Beaumont tried to submit the story about Abbott and Costello in space, and it was stolen from him. It's possible that much of the story Beaumont devised for Abbott and Costello became the basis of Queen of Outer Space. It's true there are similarities. Both pictures take their heroes to Venus. Both deal with planets populated entirely by women. In both, the queens fall for one of the Earthmen, and in both, there are a series of escapes and recaptures. The best evidence that the film was written as a spoof, which has been denied by Burns, is that Beaumont's other fantasy writing is sophisticated. It seems highly unlikely that he would expect a plot as silly as Queen of Outer Space to be taken seriously.
No, I seem to recall him telling me about this wonderful comedy that
he'd written, and then being stunned when it came out and they were playing it straight.
I can't see Chuck thinking that that thing was for serious.
No, not at all.
That was a serious movie? They brought it out as a drama?
Oh, sure.
Oh.
Heavy drama.
Yeah. Wow. In fact, somebody was telling me, they ran into Zsa Zsa the other day somewhere at some restaurant. Yeah. It can't be my Hungarian restaurant because it closed down. I need a new one. Maybe the Hollywood Wax Museum. I don't know. Who knows? You know, went in to talk to Sonny Tubbs. Yeah. Sonny Tubbs. Did you ever run into Sonny Tubbs?
Once.
Me too.
Yeah.
Does he still look good?
Not after I ran into him. No.
Ah, the Matheson family is a funny family. How's your sister, by the way?
She's good. She's doing good.
She's still writing Moonlighting?
She's
working on a film now that's being optioned by Ron Howard's company. Mm.
You people really are a menace. We're gonna have to do something. We're gonna have to wipe you screwers out.
Nukus. Nuke them in.
Well, we would have had our younger son here today, but he's in Phoenix watching them shoot a film that he and a friend wrote.
Mm-hmm. Look at the grin. Look at the grin.
He just cured cancer this afternoon.
I understand your mother discovered radium last week.
But she's keeping it quiet. It's no big thing.
It's we got about 15 minutes. Should we open the lines and take a couple of phone calls, you think? Why don't we do that? We're gonna put my... Let's see. Bert says we're not rigged here for the mic tonight, so I'm going to put my mic over there by Dat. And the number here, as usual, is 818-985-KPFK. Let's see what happens here. Hi, you're on Hour 25. Who's this?
My name is Joseph Neola. I happen to be a friend of the Beaumont family.
Oh. You do?
Yes. Three things. It was Jennings Lang who got shot in the crotch. Later, Universal.
Oh, it was Jennings Lang that...
They called him Jennings Lang.
Edward Burns happened to be a Three Stooges director, of all things, 40s. And it was, this is just a little correction for Mr. Matheson, it was Catherine Beaumont, who was the oldest daughter, is the one who played Mom when Helen passed off the scene.
Well, thank you.
Okay.
Sure.
Hey, bye.
Bye. What was that mask?
I don't know, but they called him Jennings Lang after the...
Jennings.
That's true.
Right, because he only had the one.
That's correct.
Does he do this at home all the time?
No, he doesn't live with us anymore. We threw him out because of this. He one-lined us to death, and we just threw him out.
I've been meaning to ask you. It's been a long time since you people have invited me over to dinner. Was I really that bad that night I came to dinner?
No, but you never invited us to your house.
Uh-oh.
You got to reciprocate.
Is that what it was?
Sure.
Well, hell, I wasn't married then.
Well, you are now.
You don't want to eat my cooking, Charlie. Susan.
Okay.
We'll have the math as soon as you want. You can come over.
Tonight.
Your name.
Not you. I've seen you eat, man.
That was at Marrakesh.
It's the first time I've ever seen anyone eat mashed potatoes with their hands. It's really a nauseating thing. Hi, you're on Hour 25. Oh, that was good. Was it something we said? Hi, you're on Hour 25.
What was the Green Hand?
Oh.
The Green Hand was a corporation... so-called, because I guess there were five members of it. It was a phrase that George Clayton Johnson had originated about the original group, which included Chuck Beaumont. And then later on, we incorporated. I was a member, and George was the president. Jerry Soule was a member, and Theodore Sturgeon was the other member. And we had a suite of offices in Beverly Hills. We had offices at Metro-Goldwyn-Mayer. We were doing wonderfully. Every idea we came up with, we were visiting the heads of networks, but we never made a nickel out of it.